The relational database design model and what happens in relational databases, why the problems comes in relational databases. Now during our practicals, you might have noticed that some of the students have inserted repeated data into the tables, and because of that they will not be able to delete or update or insert anything into that table. So the repeated data creates a problem for a user, because whenever there is redundancy into the database, it creates inconsistency. You are not able to get the exact details of the records, or you can say exact details of the persons from the database. When you try to delete one record, accidentally other records get also affected. They get deleted. If you try to modify that particular record, accidentally what happens is other records also gets modified. So that type of problems will going to come in unnormalized database because of redundancy. So that is the major drawback of relational database. So to avoid that particular drawback, we have the process of normalization in databases. Now what do you mean by normalization? It is a technique for producing a set of tables with desirable properties that support the requirement of a user or company. Or in short, we can say that it is a process of dividing the main table into sub-tables in such a way that there is no redundancy and there is no anomalies for insertion, updation and deletion. It is also called as the process of decomposing relations with anomalies to produce smaller relations, well-structured relations in the database. Normalization is also can be considered as a process for deciding which attributes should be grouped into a table or in a relation. It is basically used to validate and improve the logical designing of the database to satisfy certain constraints, avoid unnecessary duplication of data. So whenever you find that particular table has the redundancy, then you have to identify in which normal form it is, at which level that database is, maybe at 1NF, at 2NF, 3NF. Then you can transform it to the next higher level so that redundancy will not be there into your database. So that is the main objective of normalization. Let's see what are different objectives of normalization we have. The first important task of normalization process is to reduce the redundancy, which means that information is to be stored only once into the database. If you reduce redundancy, ultimately what will happen? The number of records will be reduced. If the number of records are reduced, in turn it reduces the size taken by the database. Am I right or wrong, students? Is it right? If you reduce the number of records, the size of the database will also reduce. Now just take an example that if your student record, say roll number 1 record, is repeated 1000 times by mistakenly in the database, then it will occupy 1000 times that memory required by that particular records unnecessarily. So if I apply normalization, that particular record will be stored only once in the database. So definitely it will going to save the memory space of the database. Second is to reduce the file storage space required by the base table. Once you remove the redundancy from the tables, ultimately it also reduces the file storage space required by the base table. Then there is one more problem that redundancy creates into the databases. If there is redundant data available in the database, it creates inconsistency. What is inconsistency? Means you are not able to get the exact information of the student. Now let's take the example. Same example. Roll number 1's data is repeated 1000 times, and say different time at in a column like marks, different values are entered. Then you are not able to exactly get how many marks that student has scored in the test, because there are so many records available with roll number 1. That is called as inconsistency. Now, the next objective is of normalization is to make it feasible to represent any relation into the database. So it should be small and precise, and there is no redundant data into the database. Then the last objective is to fill relations from undesirable insertion, updation, and deletion anomalies. Anomalies means problems created by insertion, updation, and deletion of the records into the database. So that should not happen. You should be easily insert, easily delete, or easily update that particular table at any moment. Then only you can say that it is normalized tables. If these all these operations can be easily performed on the database, then we can say that the particular database is a normalized database. Now let's understand what are different properties of normalization. First important property is no data value should be repeated or duplicated in the different rows unnecessarily. Second, a value must be specified for every attribute in a row. This is very important. So in your record, suppose student table is there, and in your record, if some column has null values, then that is not accepted in normalized database. There should not be any null value in the record. It is the second property. Third is each relation should be self-contained. In other words, we can say that if a row from a relation is deleted, important information should not be accidentally deleted from the table. It should not be lost. If you try to delete one record, it should not affect another records of the table. This is the third property of the normalization. For the fourth one, when a row is added to a relation, other relation in the database should not be affected. It means that whenever you put any data into the table, it will not unnecessarily affect the other records of the table. That should not happen. A value of an attribute in a tuple may be changed independent of other tuples in the relation or other relation. It means that you can easily update your table without affecting another records into the table. That flexibility should be there. But let's take an example, understand what is normalized, unnormalized table, unnormalized database. Let's see this table, which consists of redundant data. Can you tell me by looking at the table, where is the redundant data? In this table, where is the redundant data, student? Where is the duplication of information?
Sir, redundancy is in position and in address and in branch number also.
Very good.
So when
what about telephone number?
Numbers and
over
there also telephone number is also repeated, right? So normally users think that everything should be available in the same table. It will be very easy for them to fetch the data from the single table. Unnecessary, I will not go to merge more than one table to fetch the data. But when you keep the whole information into the same table, then this type of problem will going to occur. Branch number is repeated, branch address is repeated, telephone numbers are repeated, right? The information of the branch should be stored only once in the normalized table, right? It should not be repeated again and again. Only branch number can be repeated, but the whole information of the branch address, if your branch address is too long, say, the 100 words it consists of, then unnecessarily it will take up that much memory space into the computers, right? So that unnecessary take up memory should be avoided. So this is the best example to understand what is unnormalized data. Can we normalize this particular table, student?
Yes, sir, we can normalize the data.
If you split this table into two different tables, like staff master table and
staff
and branch master, perfect. One is staff master table and another is branch master table. So how you are going to do that? In staff master table, you have all the employee information, staff information, wherein staff number is only a primary key and the information is coming only one time. Whereas in branch table, the branch ID is the branch number is the primary key, wherein branch number will come only one because of primary key, and the information will come only once, that is address and telephone number also. But what will happen when you divide this particular table into two different tables? The branch number column, which is there into the branch table as the primary key, it has to be there into the staff master table as a foreign key. Every staff must have a branch number, then and only you can relate these two tables and you can combine these two tables via joins and you can fetch the information as per your need, right? So that can be possible by dividing this whole table into two different tables, that is staff master and branch master table. You can see this, I have written here, staff branch table has redundant data. The details of branch are repeated for every member of the staff. In contrast, the branch information appears only once. It should be appearing only once into the database for each branch in the branch table, and only the branch number is repeated in the staff table to represent where each member of the staff is located. Tables that contain redundant information may potentially suffer from the three different types of anomalies called as insertion anomaly, deletion anomaly, and updation anomaly. So what do you mean by insertion anomaly? Let's try to insert one record of staff into the above table, that is staff branch. For that, you also need to insert the branch details that are consistent with the existing details of the same branch. Then only you can insert a record into above table, a normalized table. So it is hard to maintain the data consistency with staff branch. It means without branch information, I can't insert the staff detail in above table, unnormalized table, right? I must know the details of staff as well as his branch information. Then only I can insert the data into the above table, right? The second anomaly is delete anomaly. Let's try to delete for a member of his staff from the staff branch table. You can delete any member of his staff from the staff branch table. What will happen? You will also lose the branch details information in that row. Let's see that table. If you delete, suppose the first record, Tom's record, who is a manager in this table, if you delete this, the information of the branch also gets deleted. So this should not happen, right? If you are deleting a staff from the staff table, only staff should be removed and the branch information should be there into the database. That is called as delete anomalies. Third is updation anomaly. Let's try to update the value of one of the attributes of a branch table. You also need to update that information in all the rows about the same branch. So if you do any modification into this, say branch address is changed from branch 001, consider that the branch address is now changed to the new address, say, then what you have to do is you have to look for all the records wherein B001 is the branch. In all those records, you need to modify the branch address, new address, right? So unnecessary, that task will be adding a extra time for us. That type of anomaly is called as update anomaly. Let's understand what is now the process of decomposition, how we can divide the tables, and what happens if you divide the tables? Is it a loss? Is it going to provide us the correct information by applying the join? If you get the same information from the divided table, though, if you are able to fetch the original table, if you are able to get the original table, it is called as lossless join property. Decomposition is the process of dividing the main table into subtables, right? There are two important properties of decomposition. The first important property is lossless join decomposition. So here, to understand what is lossless join decomposition, you divide the main entity into main table into subtables, suppose. And in the reverse order, if you are able to get the original table back by joining of lower level tables, then that type of joining without a loss of information, then that type of join is called as lossless join property. Then there is one more important property in this, is that dependency preservation property. It enables us to enforce a constraint on original relation to original relation by enforcing some constraint on each of the smaller relations, subdivided relations. It means you have a main table and then that is divided into subtables, and these subtables are connected to each other via primary key and foreign key relationship. There must be some dependency. Then only you should be able to join these tables. And that property is called as dependency preservation property. there should not be any table which is not related to the current database, means which does not have a primary key or foreign key. Then it is not going to satisfy the second property, that is called dependency preservation property. Any questions, students? Now, before going to the actual process of normalization, I just want to know any doubts. Do you have any doubts till now? We have seen the definition of normalization, then different anomalies into the unnormalized database. We have seen one example of unnormalized table. Then we understand what is decomposition processes, and now we are going to actually start applying the process of normalization on unnormalized database. Till now, any questions, students?
No, sir.
Okay. This PDF is already uploaded on Google Classroom. You can see here in the stream section. If you go the first file, you will get the PDF of notes on module number 5. For your reference, you can download it from here. Now we will move to the next point. What are different steps we follow in normalization? So, from unnormalized database, we go to first normal form. Then we move to the second normal form. Then we go to third normal form in the forward direction. Then Boyce code normal form. Then we have fourth normal form. Then fifth normal form, and so on. But in the process of this normalization, we only bother about the first normal form to third normal form. If your database is in third normal form, then we can consider such database as a good database in corporates, in companies, right? If your database is in third normal form, we can consider such database as a good database. Now let's understand what we perform in first normal form. In first normal form, we actually delete multi-value attributes. Any multi-value attributes have been removed. So what is multi-value attribute, students? If your phone number is repeated, say more than one value for the same column, phone number column has multiple phone numbers for a student, then that is multi-value attribute. So if your database consists of such attributes, then it has to be removed, and that is the job of a first normal form. What we do in second normal form, we try to find out the functional dependencies. What is functional dependency? There is a primary key foreign key relationship between the columns. If the values of one column relates with exactly one value of another column, then that is called fully functional dependency. If the value of one column does not depend on exactly one value of another column, that is called as partial functional dependency. So we look for partial functional dependencies in second normal form. We try to find partial functional dependencies in second normal form, and we try to delete that. So job of second normal form is any partial functional dependencies has to be removed. What is the job of third normal form? In third normal form, we look for transitive dependencies. What is transitive dependency, student? If suppose there are three columns in a table, A relates to B, B relates with C, then ultimately A relates with C. This is a transitivity dependency, right? So if such relationship exists in a database, if first column depends on second, or if it determines second column, if second column determines third column, then ultimately A determines third column. If such dependencies exist into the database, transitivity exists into the database, it has to be removed. So in third normal form, any transitive dependencies have been removed. In between third and fourth normal form, we also have one more normal form that is called as Boyce code normal form. In this, any remaining anomalies that results from the functional dependencies have been removed. If still any anomalies or functional anomalies or dependencies exist after 3NF, that can be removed by BCNF. Then we have fourth NF. Here we are actually deleting the multi-valued dependencies. So we identify, are there any multi-valued dependencies exist between the database columns? If it is there, then that has to be removed in the fourth normal form. In fifth normal form, any anomaly is still just suppose in the database till the fourth normal form. If your database still have any remaining anomalies, then that anomaly has to be removed in fifth normal form. But according to the Bimbane syllabus, you must bother about first, second, third BCNF normal form. Fourth and fifth is not there in your syllabus. Okay. Just understand this particular steps by using this diagram. But consider that the first step, we have a table having multi-value attribute, or you have a database, and in that database you have tables having multi-value attributes. So when you go to the first normal form, you can see it is shown in the ellipse. What we are doing in this process, we are removing multi-value attributes. Then your table will be in the first normal form. When you go from first normal form to second normal form, we have to remove partial dependencies. See, it is shown in the second ellipse. Then when you go from second normal form to third normal form, we have to remove all the transitive dependencies that exist in the database. When you go from third normal form to BCNF or Boy Scout normal form, we have to remove remaining anomalies resulting from functional dependencies. That is done by BCNF. When you go from BCNF to 4NF, we actually remove multi-valued dependency. At last, when you go from 4NF to 5NF, 4 normal form to 5th normal form, we remove all the remaining anomalies after 4NF. If it is there, we can apply 5th normal form and we can remove that anomaly. So these are the steps involved into the normalization process. So you cannot directly apply 5th normal form on the database. You have to go step by step. If you are given, suppose, unnormalized database, then you will first look for in which normal form it is. Suppose it is in second normal form, you can transform it to next higher level normal form, that is 3NF. You can't go back. You can go forward to 3NF. If it is in 3NF, you can move it to the BCNF or 4NF and so on. If your database is in 1NF, you can shift it to second normal form by removing the partial dependencies. Likewise, we have to apply the steps. Let us understand after normalization what will happen. When you apply the first normal form, your database will look like the outer circle. There is still this outer circle indicates that your database still consists of some redundant information or some partial dependencies, transitive dependencies, multi-valued dependencies still persist in 1NF. Then we apply second normal form, the second outer circle, you can say, right? So that will remove some unwanted data from 1NF. Then your database size gets reduced, right? When you apply third normal form, it again gets reduced. When you apply BCNF, it gets reduced. When you apply 4NF, it gets again reduced. When you apply 5NF, again it gets reduced. And there is one more normal form that you will study in your masters, that is domain key normal form. It is represented by asterisk here. Yeah? So have you understood? This is just for representing size of the database. When you apply this 1NF, there are certain redundancies. When you apply 2NF, that will be removed and your database size will be reduced. So when you apply the next higher from normal form, your database size will again reduce. With this, you can understand from this particular diagram the effect of normalization. In the process of normalization, we follow 2 to 3 steps. Sometimes a database will be given to you, tables are given to you, or relations are given to you, and the examiner may ask you, find out in which normal form that tables are, and transform that table to the next higher level normal form. So that process involves 3 steps. Given a relation, use the following cycle or steps. First of all, we have to find out what normal form it is in. Whatever the database that is given to you in exam, you have to find out what normal form it is in. Second, transform the relation to the next higher form by decomposing it to form simpler relations. You need to refine the relation further if decomposition resulted in undesirable properties. That will be taken care in step three. Now let's start with the first NF. Understand what is first NF is. A relation is in first NF if and only if all the underlying domains contain atomic values into it. It means that all the columns of that table must contain only one value for a record. A table in which the intersection of every column and record contains only one value, then that is called as atomic. If you consider this particular table here, it is a branch table having information of branch number, branch address, telephone numbers. So one branch can have many telephone numbers. Similarly, the second branch has many telephone numbers and so on. So it is a table having redundant information. More than one value. So it is, this particular table is not in a first normal form. A table is having multi-value attribute in it. So it is not in first normal form. Here itself we understand that it is not in the first normal form. Then how to transform this table into second normal form? The steps are, when you go from unnormalized form to 1NF, first we have to identify which is the primary key of this table. Nominate an attribute or group of attributes to act as a primary key for this unnormalized table. Then second, identify the attributes, multi-value attributes in unnormalized table, which repeats for the key attribute. So if I consider branch number as the primary key, for this telephone numbers are many. So I can say that telephone number is a multi-value attribute here. Then how to decompose this particular table into smaller tables, different tables? So I will divide this particular table into two different tables. One will going to store the branch information, another will going to store the branch telephone numbers information. See this. Now this particular table will be divided into two tables. One is branch having only two columns, that is branch number and branch address. And another table will be there. Here branch number, which is the primary key of the master table, will be taken as foreign key. And second column would be telephone number. So B001 has three telephone numbers. So that will be represented like this: B001, first telephone number, B001, second telephone number, and so on. Likewise, second branch, first telephone number, second branch, second telephone number, and so on. But here, if you see, the intersection of column and the record have only one value. That is nothing but atomic. All the domain values in the tables must be atomic. Then and then only we can say that that table is in first normal form. Okay, have you understood, student, from this particular example? Have you understood what is first normal form and how to convert any unnormalized table to first normal form? Please quickly write in the chat box. Have you understood what is 1NF is? Very good. So many of you are saying yes. This topic is very, very important from your exam point of view, because the complete module consists of normalization, and definitely we will expect 10 marks question on this module. So understanding in detail the different normal form is very important. So we completed first normal form till now, and there are no doubts, right? So we'll slowly move to the next higher level normal form, and we'll understand what is the second normal form, how to move from one normal form to the second normal form, or how to convert any one normal form tables to second normal form. Let's see the second type of normal form, that is second normal form. A relation or a table is in second normal form if it is in first normal form. First of all, when you consider a relation is in second normal form, it has to be there in the first normal form. And every non-key attribute is fully functionally dependent on the primary key of the relation. This is very, very important, student. Every non-key attribute is fully dependent on the primary key of the relation. So you identified which is the primary key in the 1NF, right? So which are the non-key attributes, students? Non-key attributes are not the primary keys of the table. So all other columns of the tables can be considered as non-key attribute. So all those non-key attributes should be fully functional dependent on the primary key of the relation. Then and then only we can say that that particular relation is in second normal form. Generally, we apply 2NF to the tables with composite primary key or which has composite primary keys. Before going to the example, we must understand what is functional dependency is. So consider a table or a relation having two attributes, that is A and B into it. Then B is fully functional dependent on A if each value of A in the table R is associated with exactly one value of B in the table R. It means that there is one-to-one relationship between the attributes of A and B, domain values of A and B. So we can say that A determines B, and it is represented by A arrow B. So this indicates that A determines B. B is, in other words, we can say that B is fully dependent on A. Student, it is very important how to read this particular example. It is A determines B. This is one thing. Second is B is fully dependent on A. B is the non-key attribute, whereas A is the key attribute. So we are interested in finding such functional dependencies among the database relations. Now, what do you mean by determinant in this functional dependency? Determinant is any attribute which appearing on the left-hand side of the arrow. In this particular A is to B, A is appearing on the left-hand side of the arrow. So this is considered as determinant.
Sir, which is the primary key, A or B?
A is the primary key. B is the non-key attribute, other attributes of the relation.
Okay, sir.
Determinant of the functional dependency refers to an attribute or group of attributes on the left-hand side of the arrow. So you must understand this. So all that you can say primary key or composite keys would be there on the left-hand side, which determines the right-hand side attribute. If the determinant can maintain the fully functional dependency with minimum number of attributes, then we call such a functional dependency as fully functional dependency. So have you understood what do you mean by functional dependency? If the values in an attribute, one attribute, is exactly related with only one value of another attribute, there is one-to-one relationship between primary key and another column, say, or a primary key determines another column, then we can say that it is fully functional dependency. And if it is not, suppose, if it is not determining the values in the another column, then that is called as partial dependency. If you are not able to get the information of the second column from the first column, then it is not a fully functional dependency, it is partial dependency. Let us understand by these steps. When I convert one normal form table to second normal form, the first step is that identify the primary key of the first normal form relation. Once you identify the primary key, then in the second step, identify the functional dependencies in a relation. Whether it may be fully functional dependency or partial dependencies, we have to identify all the functional dependencies in a relation. But our major focus should be only on the partial dependencies out of it. If your relation consists of partial dependencies into it on the primary key, then we remove those partial dependencies by passing them into a new relation along with the copy of the primary key, or you can say determinant. Let's see the example to understand these steps. Here, student, it is a table of star branch where you have the information of staff, you have the information of branch, and you also have one more information, that is how many hours that staff worked for a branch. So hours per week will be there into the last column. Let us understand the meaning of this particular table. If you focus on the first two columns to identify other columns information, I can use staff number and branch number. If I want to know how many hours that particular staff has worked in a branch, I must use staff number and branch number. From that only I will get number of hours the staff work in a branch. So it is fully functional dependency of hours per week on these two columns. So it's a composite primary key. When there are more than one column involved into the primary key, then it is called as composite primary key. Now let's see another example. I can get the information of the branch address by the branch number. So this is not fully functional dependency on the composite primary key. If I consider these two columns as the primary key of this table commonly, then this type of dependency, like determining branch address from branch number, is not in second. And this is partial dependency, right? It is only dependent on branch number column. Similarly, name can be obtained from staff number. Name of the staff can be obtained from staff number. That is also not in 2NF. Position of the staff can be obtained from staff number. That is also not in 2NF. If all the attributes of this table are determined by the composite primary key, then there is no problem. It is in 2NF. But right now, what is happening here is only one column is there, which is dependent on both the columns, whereas other columns are dependent on branch number or the staff number. So that is called as partial dependency, right? So if the table consists of partial dependencies, can we say the student, this is in 1NF, this particular table? Yes, sir, please tell me. Can we consider this table as a 1NF table?
Yes, sir.
Yes, because there is no repetition of attribute values. There is no multi-value attribute. It is in 1NF. But is the table have all the columns fully dependent on the primary key?
No, sir.
No, it is not. Because there is only one column which fully dependent on staff number and branch number. But whereas the other columns are dependent on branch number or staff number, which is called as partial dependency. It has to be removed from this table. So to remove that partial dependency, we will split this table. We will divide this table into two different tables. One will be staff master, another will be branch master, and there would be one more table that will going to give me the information of how many hours that staff worked in a particular branch. So there would be three tables. When you divide this particular table, there would be three tables like this. Here it is, the main table above, right? So below we have branch master, then this is temporary staff master, you can say this. It will going to store staff information, and the last table will going to store the information of hours per week. And here staff number and branch number is the composite primary key, or you can say individually they becomes the foreign keys in the table. In branch master table, branch number is primary key. Staff master, staff number would be the primary key, whereas staff master and staff number and branch number column in this third table, they are foreign keys. So by this, I can easily link these two, three tables, and I can get the information. And right now, all the tables are in 1NF as well as in 3NF. So it is in 2NF. All these tables are in second normal form. Because if you see, the non-key attributes of each table, they are fully functional dependent on the primary key of that table. Let's take the example of branch. Branch address can be determined from branch number. So that is fully functional dependency. Now let's see the example of name and position. Name and position can be determined from the staff number. That's why you can say there is fully functional dependency. Now go to the third table. I can get the information of hours per week from this composite primary key, that is staff number and branch number. Again, there is a fully functional dependency. It means there is right now there is no partial dependency exists here. That's why we can say that this particular table is in second normal form. Have you understood, student? The second normal form. Are there any questions from your side? Yes, okay. Any other student having any doubt in 1NF or 2NF? No questions. Good. So you understood. The PDF is already shared with you. I want everyone to go and study the notes today itself to understand this concept thoroughly. The notes are very self-explanatory. You can use it. Now we'll see the next higher normal form. To go to the third normal form. Now, how to go to third normal form from second normal form? How to convert second normal form tables into third normal form? Suppose you identified that your database is in second normal form and you want to further normalize it, then you have to apply 3NF. Right? So, what we do in 3NF? A relation or table is in third normal form if it is in second normal form, first of all, and every non-key attribute of relation R is non-transitively dependent on the primary key of R. In the definition, it is clearly mentioned that every non-key attribute should be non-transitively dependent on the primary key of a relation. In other words, we can say that the non-key attributes should not be dependent transitively. It means there should not be any transitive dependency in between any columns of a relation or third normal form tables. For example, consider a table having three attributes A, B, and C. B functionally dependent on A. It means A determines B. A determines B. And now C is functionally dependent on B. It means that B determines C. Right. Then C, in turn, we can say that is transitively dependent on A via B, provided that A is not functionally dependent on B or C. It means that A is the primary key here. A is the primary key. So transitive dependency exists, suppose. This type of transitive dependency exists in your database. Then that has to be removed by placing them into some different relations, different tables. If a transitive dependency exists on a primary key, the table cannot be considered as a table in third normal form. Let's understand what are different steps involved when you go from second normal form to third normal form. There are three steps again. The first step is always identifying the primary key in the second normal form tables. Identify functional dependencies in a relation. And the third step is, if the transitive dependency exists on the primary key, then we have to remove that transitive dependency by placing them in a new relation along with copy of their determinant. Along with the copy of their determinant is always the primary key, right? So you have to take the primary key into the another table, and that would be considered as the foreign key, just for linking these two tables into the third normal form. So the most important
point is identifying, are there any transitive dependency in second normal form tables? If they are there, then they has to be removed by placing them such attributes into a new table along with the copy of their determinant, that is called as primary key of that table.
Let's understand these three steps by the example. Now consider a combined table, that is star branch,
which is not in 3NF. And can you tell me now, student, why these are not in 3NF? Just looking at the attributes of this table, by looking at the data present into the table, can we say that this table is not in 3NF? And if it is not in 3NF, what are the reasons? Are there any transitive dependency? Identify. See, this table, if we consider all the columns of this table, can be obtained or determined from staff number. So I can say that A is to B is there.
So when you determine all other columns, this is represented by A is to B relationship. A is to B. A arrow B, correct? Now, just focus on branch number column. Branch number can determine branch address and telephone number. So you can say this is B is to C relationship. B is to C relationship. Now let's understand. The column number 2 of branch table, that is branch address, can determine branch number as well as telephone number.
So here what is happening is C determines D or C determines B is happening. If I see, consider C branch address at C attribute, it can determine further attributes, or it is determining also the primary key of that relation. So reverse is not possible. No? So there is a transitive dependency, and that dependency has to be removed.
Values of branch address and telephone number column can be worked out from branch number. So table is not in 3NF. If you see, values in branch number and telephone number columns can be worked out from branch address. So again, your table is not in 3NF. Then the last one. I can get the information of branch address and the branch number from the telephone number, because telephone numbers are unique. Right? I can get this particular information of branch and their branch number. So values in branch number and branch address columns can be worked out from telephone number. So that table is not in 3NF. It means that transitive dependencies are there in this particular table. It has to be removed by place into some another different table. So we need to split this table into a different table. So I will split this particular table into two tables. One is staff master and another is branch master. In branch master, I will have three columns, that is branch number, branch address and telephone number. In another table, I will have, in staff master, I will have the columns, that is staff number, name of the staff, position, the salary, and branch number information. Now, when you divided this particular table into two different tables, let's check the divided tables or normalized tables. Are there any transitive dependency exists there? Now, let's focus on the branch table. Are there any transitive dependency? A is to B is there, but B is to C is also there, but C is to A is not there. You can see here also in staff table, this primary can determine all other columns. So A is to B relationship is there. Right? So only one thing that we need to do is, we need to add one more column, that is branch number column, into the staff table, wherein we assign a branch to the staff. And by combining these two tables or joining these two tables, I will get the above table back. It is because of normalization only. So whenever you divide the table into subtables, and if you are able to get back the original table by joining operation, then that is called as lossless join decomposition. And dependency preservation property is also satisfied, because you see here, it is the primary key, branch number is the primary key, here it is foreign key. This branch number is dependent on this branch number for further information of the branch and telephone number for a staff. I will get this information of branch address and telephone number of a staff only when I have the branch number with me. So the dependency preservation property is also satisfied. So we, whenever you divide or normalize the database, we always look for two properties. One is called as lossless join property, whether that normalizable satisfies lossless join property as well as dependency preservation property. So these are these two tables satisfy those properties. We can consider these two tables are in now in 3NF. There are no transitive dependencies exist, and also there are no partial dependencies exist. You can consider a table in 3NF only when it is in 2NF, first of all, and second is there are no transitive dependencies exist on the primary key of the table. So this is, you can say, in 3NF. Okay, have you understood, student, how to convert any unnormalized table which is there in 2NF to 3NF? So we have taken this example, a table which is not in 3NF, and we converted this table into 3NF. Please reply in the chat box. Have you understood how to convert any table from 2NF to 3NF? Are there any question till 3NF? You understood? Very good. So I'm going to ask you some question now. Only 2-3 minutes are remain. So quickly we'll take some question answer session now, and we'll revise the concepts of normalization. Now my first question to all of you is, why normalization is needed, students? Write your answer in the chat box. Any one reason that why normalization is needed in the database? Let me check answers. Good. Many of you have given me the correct answer. To reduce the redundancy, to avoid redundancy. Main focus is redundancy, correct. Now, tell me, if redundancy is there, then what problem will going to come? Yes, to avoid duplication. What will happen if redundancy is there in your database? Is it harmful?
So we cannot access the data if redundancy is there.
What?
It will be very difficult.
There are three anomalies, three problems will going to occur. If redundant data is there in your database, there are three problems will going to occur. That is insertion anomalies, deletion anomaly, and updation anomaly. It will going to create problem for insertion, deletion, and updation of the database. And the answer is given by Bharat correctly. Now my next question to you. We have seen in a diagram what we do in first normal form. What is the job of first normal form? Very good. Lalit has written, remove multi-valued attribute from the unnormalized table. Very good. So in first normal form, we actually remove multi-value attribute. Second normal form, what do we do in second normal form? Yes, it is partially correct. Lalit has given me the answer as establish A is to be relationship, or we remove partial dependencies. Yes, Rishikesh has given the correct answer. We actually remove the partial dependencies from the database, and we only keep the fully functional dependent columns into the table. Then only we can say that it is in second normal form. Last question now. What we do in third normal form, students? In third normal form. Very good. Very good. So we look for transitive dependencies in third normal form, and we remove those transitive dependencies from the third normal form. Excellent. The answers are correct. Thank you. So now we'll stop here and we'll see the remaining portion in the next lecture. Thank you very much for